Well, for the small end value, I think that's right. Because it's like you guys like to be higher. It's so shallow.
Yeah, because sometimes eventually you get fire.
That's right. So,
yeah.
And that's fine. You're not going to do that.
Yeah. But because when you get fire, like just okay, and that just covers up.
Testing.
So what you can do is once it's on, you can check the return to it.
Probably, guys, we should start. Yeah, that's good. Okay, cool. Good morning, everyone. So today we are going to, first of all, questions from previous classes or assignments. If it's a more detailed question, we can look after. Okay. So today the idea is to review very quickly our knowledge of linear algebra. We are going to touch several points. It's going to be fast. It's going to be a lot of material. So don't feel intimidated. Just the idea is to refresh some concepts and try to make contact with what we are going to see in next class, which are the applications of this. Okay? So linear algebra is huge. And the course I took in linear algebra took a whole year, like 2 semesters. So we're going to try to condensate all that in what, 40 minutes or so. So it's going to be fast and it's going to be a lot of material. Okay, so feel free to ask questions and feel free to come to us after class or during office hours for reviewing material that you may have not seen before. The truth is that we do this mostly because most of the algorithms that we are going to use and implement in computational science or scientific computing, one way or another will end up having something to deal with linear algebra methods. Either when we want to solve a differential equation and we have to discretize the equation, we're going to see examples that will end up being a problem of matrix multiplication. Either when you solve linear systems and you need to find the solutions, that it can be casted very simply and directly into a linear algebra problem. Eigenvalue problems, stability analysis, interactive and direct methods can be casted and formalized in linear algebra. So many of those we are going to see, and many of those require some knowledge and some understanding of linear algebra. That's why basically we are going to spend this class and next class reviewing and looking at these concepts. So let's get started. So very simple, very easy beginning. Vectors are a very important part of linear algebra. Vectors can be generalized into higher dimensional objects, but having a three-dimensional interpretation allows you to have a geometric picture of what is that. It can be associated with operations between vectors and scalars. Sometimes it's called the body of the set. And that basically allows you to multiply a vector by a scalar. It allows you to add 2 vectors. It will allow you to create the dot product, which is a principal player in all this linear algebra business. And most of these concepts you probably have seen already. By having all this in place, we are allowed to construct something more general and more rich, which is a vector space. And basically, for building a vector space, you need the actors, which are the vectors themselves. And then you need to define a set that is composed of the null element. So a vector basically equivalent to the null element. And then operations between the vectors, like the addition of the vectors, the scalar multiplication of a vector and a scalar, and then the inner product between 2 vectors. By having all this in place, and you will be able to create a vector space. And this concept that will sound like very theoretical is actually the base of many other applications that we develop on top of linear natural. There are formal definitions of vector spaces. It's kind of what is written there, but basically the idea is that having these sets in place allow us to create new tools for dealing with operations through linear natural. One of the things that is useful as well is to know which two vectors are orthogonal, meaning that there are no components in common between the directions that the two vectors define. How we do that? Well, we can look at the inner product of these two vectors. These definitions are completely abstract in the sense that they don't need the representation of the coordinate bases. But if you had a representation of coordinate bases, this has a very explicit formula that you can use. So if you had two vectors that the inner product is equal to zero, then those vectors are orthogonal, meaning that there are no components that they can contribute in the same direction of the vectors. If in addition to that, the inner product of two vectors is equal to one, it means that the dimensionalities of the vector are normalized, and they are said to be orthonormal. So the first one, sorry, is orthogonal, and the second one is orthogonal. Okay. The nice thing of orthogonal vectors is that if you have a dimension of the vector space of dimension n, and you have n orthogonal vectors, those are the basis of your domain, of your vector space. So with n orthogonal vectors, you can reconstruct the whole vector space. Is that clear? Is some familiar? Haven't heard this at all before. With the idea of vector spaces and bases, then comes the idea of changing bases. So I have a vector space of dimension n, I have n vectors, but I would like to change the representation of my vector space by changing the base. One way to do it is to construct a higher dimensional object, a matrix, that will allow you to basically change those bases. How we do that? Well, assume that we have a vector x of dimension n, and we have n components of this vector. Then we can choose n different vectors that are going to be the vectors that allow you to change the base. Okay? If you put together these n new vectors in a matrix all together, that represents the change of basis matrix. Okay? So these A1, A2, AN are n vectors that conform or form the change of basis matrix. Okay? The way to very concrete and short way to write it is the matrix A times the vector X, which was the original vector, equal to the new vector B in the new basis. Okay. What else? Given AX equal B, X is the unique vector of the coefficients that this represents in a given base of columns of A. And then the other thing that you can do is you can represent the new elements or the new vectors of the basis of the new bases given by the matrix A with new E1, E2, EN for a given representation of the vector X in the old bases. Okay? So basically, this is the components I was telling you before. So you can represent all of them through the inner product by just multiplication of the coefficients of each of the vectors. So there is associated to that another space that one can think of. It's called the column space of A, of the matrix of basis transformation, that is spanned by the column of the vectors AI. So each of the columns is a new vector and spans a new space. And these are, as I mentioned before, the vectors that you use for transforming the coordinates, and they are linear combination of AI. So when you do, let's see. To go too much into details, but when you do AX equal B, this can be seen as AA J, XJ, BI. So and here you do the multiplication and you multiply each of the coefficients of X by each of the columns of the matrix A. Another way to think of this, and this is a whole topic in linear algebra, is a linear transformation. So you can think, okay, I have my original vector x, I multiply the vector x by a matrix A, and this has to be a linear transformation if A, or the vector space defined by the columns of A, actually is a vector space. Why is that? Well, you can show that there are certain rules that that transformation has to hold. And for instance, if you apply A to a vector x1, you will have b1. If you apply A to a vector x2, you will have b2. And then if you apply A to the addition of x1 plus x2, you will have b1 plus b2. So that's the linearity property of the transformation. In addition to that, if you multiply the vector by a scalar, the result should be the transformed vector multiplied by the same scalar. So that's the definition of the linear transformation. In addition to that, you can add that the linear transformation applied to the null element of the vector has to be the null element. So the null element remains invariant under the transformation. Okay? These are very important because many geometrical operations can be associated with linear transformations, and many other things can be associated with linear transformations as well. Okay? So this is just the beginning. Another important thing to understand is the range of a matrix, or the range of the matrix of basis change in this case. So being an element B that belongs to the range of A means that there exists a vector, an original vector, such that the matrix applied to that vector will return you the element B. So it's like a pre-image of the new vector that you are obtaining. And if the vector space is a vector space, and if the matrix is actually a linear transformation, that should hold. Okay? And you can take, for instance, the identity vector, and you see that you will get B as each of the elements of the columns forming the matrix A. Okay? As I said, this, most of these things that review are it's not necessary that we know all of them, but just to refresh them. The other interesting thing of the linear transformations is the null space or null subspace of the matrix. And those are vectors that map to zero. So after applying the linear transformation, I should get zero. And this is for any vector x that is not zero. I told you that the element zero, when you apply the linear transformation, should give you zero. But there may be vectors that may give you zero also when they are not the null element. Okay? So those are defined like the null subspace of the transformation, of the linear transformation. In some cases, this is important because it may change the dimensionality of the resulting of your subspace. And also it's important because for matrices that has a non-empty null space, the equation AX equal B may have no solutions or infinitely many solutions. So it's a kind of not well-defined problem. So okay, that's why it's important to know the dimensionality of the null space of the transformation. Okay, is that clear? Another equivalent way to think about this is to look at the rank. And you can think of the column rank or the row rank, which is basically the dimension of the range of the transformation. And you see, I'm using equivalent terms like transformation or linear transformation or a matrix, if you want. A matrix is a representation of a linear transformation. So one thing that is important to know or remember is that the rank of a matrix A is the dimension of its column space, or it can be also seen as the row space. Basically, it's the minimum number of basis vectors in that transformation. For a square matrix, n by n, a full matrix, the full rank of the matrix has a rank n, meaning that there are no vectors that are multiplication of previous vectors. So all the vectors in the matrix, composing the matrix, has to be independent. I mentioned this, you can think about the column rank or the row rank. It's not obvious, but it's true. So people in general say just the rank. Basically, in the same way that you can transform vectors, you can transform or rotate a matrix, and that allow you to see columns or rows. Okay. This is just another mathematical equality. When you had the rank of the matrix and you had the rank of the null subspace of the matrix, that gives you the number of columns of the matrix. Meaning that, as we were saying before, if nullity, which is another way to call the rank of the null space, is zero, then the rank of the matrix has to, be equal to the number of columns in the matrix. If the rank subspace is not zero, the rank null subspace is not zero, then we are in the case where we can have infinite solutions for the equation AX equal B or not. Okay? So all these concepts and terms come together to have like a closed picture. And another thing that comes into play and is related to all these concepts is the invertibility of the matrix. Okay? This is true for square matrices, but it can be generalized to non-square matrices, meaning that when you have m times n elements in the matrix, unless it's easy to see in the square case, so m by m matrix, it says to have an inverse a to the minus one is the notation, such that a times a to the minus one has to be equal to a to the minus one times a equal to the identity, which is a matrix with all the diagonal equal to one. Okay, and recall that the matrix product is not commutative, so that's why it's only in this case and particular cases that you can see that a times b is equal to b times a. In this case, it's because it's equal to the identity matrix. Questions? Okay. Assuming that we have an inverse, that the inverse of the matrix exists, all these things, and this is all proved by theorems, all these things are equivalent. If the matrix has an inverse, then the rank of A of the matrix is equal to the dimension of the column space, equal to n in this case. The range is equal to the real number body of the vector space to the n. Don't worry about that much. The null space of A is empty, so there are no vectors when I apply the matrix A to my vector space that will end up in the null vector in spite of the zero element. There are no eigenvalues. We are going to see, you probably remember what an eigenvalue is, but there are no eigenvalues of value zero. There are no singular values zero, and the determinant of the matrix is non-zero. All these things are equivalent. And they are if and only if. So you can find one of them, you are sure that the system is inverse. Yep.
What's the fastest way to calculate?
Depends on the problem, but if you have access to the rank, if you know how the rank, that's maybe. If not, the determinant is always a good thing that you can compute. Some of them are based, if you want to compute numerically the eigenvalues, some cases, some formulations depends on the determinant. So some of them, they may be involved. Okay? But one thing that I will try to emphasize by the end of this lecture is try never, ever to compute the inverse because it's very expensive. So your question is important because computing inverses are expensive. But somehow we need to know if the matrix is invertible for solving some problems, like AX equal B. Yeah.
So if we have an algorithm that is convertible based on its determinant, and the algorithm calculus, I can hardly imagine that it's a zero.
Well, no, it may happen that the determinant is zero, right? It may happen that the determinant is zero.
It may happen to any analytic test, but the algorithm calculated.
Oh, you mean numerically? Well, remember that we talked about this some lectures ago, right? If you are testing for whatever numerical value you want to test, never test, especially with floating points, for equality. In this case, you will need to test for tolerance, like having 10 to the minus, I don't know, 7, 5, something like that. Okay. Any other questions? So let's look at this system. So usually people refer AX equal B as linear systems where you need to solve for X. Okay. I told you just this seconds ago, never invert. It's very expensive. it's slow. It's less stable when you invert because there are more computations involved. And we are going to see this. If you have a matrix that has a special structure, like if it is a sparse matrix with a lot of zeros and few elements that are non-zero, when you try to find the inverse of that, it will destroy your sparsity. Meaning that, oh, what happened?